pleasure to be with you this morning. Thank you for our brothers and sisters and for everyone who is invested in any dimension of the work across the world. Thank you for this course, Glorious Truth, called Fundamental Seeds. As we round up this course today, or maybe today and tomorrow, we ask that your grace be unleashed for us to receive what you are giving to us in the now. And Lord, help everyone who is in the masterclass to truly apprehend what you are saying in the now. To you be all honor and glory, Father. In Yeshua's mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, we welcome you to the Authentic Kingdom Culture Live broadcast for today. And today, as we have come to this place, you know, just a minute, let me ask the sound. Is the sound coming up very well? Those of you who are live, who are also on Daybreak with the King, please give us feedback. Is the sound coming up well?
The sound is well on the audible part, Apostle George.
Okay. Amen. Bless you. Thank you so much. All right. So now today we're going to do lesson 19, and if there's time, we'll do lesson 20. Both of them have to do with the epilogue, the course 105, the nine fundamental seeds. And what I say to all those who are watching, those who are listening, this is a new way of spiritual empowerment and education. It's a way the Father began to give, you know, since 1996, and then accentuated in the year 2006, which is the Father is not happy with the stifling effects of theological education, which is so academicalized and so much stiffened that it loses value. And so the Lord is saying, take my word out of the freezing, you know, deep freezers where men have put them in theological seminaries and Bible colleges, and bring it alive, bring it to the public square, that as many as I call will hear. And so what we are doing through various means, Facebook, you know, television, through radio, through conference call, through YouTube, through various means of study. You can study structured in a classroom of the masterclass. 9 months when Pastor Grace and I, we take people through what the Father has brought into our spirit man for his body, or through the Global School of Ministry in various centers across the world. And one of the greatest moves of the Lord in terms of the Global School of Ministry is in the nation of South Africa, at the southernmost tip of Africa, where there are, you know, the School of Ministry across the nation. The centers are popping up, and people are laying hold, and those trained are taking on, you know, duty of care to train others. And in different parts of the world, the story is being replicated. Liberia, other places, we see that happening. Cote d'Ivoire. And the Lord is saying, these platforms have been put in place to enable us to be without excuse. And so today, lesson 19 of Epilogue Part 1, we look at the 12 imperatives. If you are going to truly understand the fundamental seeds and walk in them and be profited by them, there are 12 key points to note. Number one, Elohim created, redeemed, and called every individual member of his family for a specific purpose on this side of eternity. Every single one has a calling of the Father upon their life. And religion doesn't teach this. Christian religion is based on the dichotomy between a tiny professional male-dominated clergy and a vast majority of people called the laity. But the axe is laid at the root of the tree that the Father wants us to remember. No one is redeemed to be called laity. Everyone is redeemed to be functionally relevant. Everyone is redeemed with a calling, and nobody's calling can in any way suppress or should suppress that of another. No. The kingdom is so wide that two birds cannot collide. Just as two birds cannot collide in the sky, two destinies can never collide in the kingdom. There's enough room for everybody. So nobody should be scared. No pastor should be scared. No overseer should be scared. Oh, if people to know their callings, then have no business. No, you have enough business. In fact, your business increases. And if you doubt that, come to London, come to Arise Metropolitan Assembly, where if you get to the fellowship, almost half of the people you see are already ministers who have gone through training and ordained. Come and see how the Lord is affecting the world through a small congregation. Whether I'm talking about Global School of Ministry, talking about Masterclass, talking about IMF, talking about the Frontline Intercessors, talking about Global Missions Board. Come and see how a ministry has been dynamically wired away from churchianity onto the heartbeat of the Father. Come and see the Go Ye teams and how every Saturday they are out there on the streets. They are out there in the marketplaces, men and brethren. And you know what? It is doable. I said to people, if we preach only and we don't do it, then you have cause to say it doesn't work. But this is a case where it works. In fact, the reason why Pastor Grace and I can travel to different nations of the world, different regions, is simply because the work in London has been structured around Yeshua. And everyone knows that you are called by the Lord. Amen and brethren, it is so important that everyone discover, because if you don't discover, the Bible says in the book of Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12 to 14, for when for the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of Elohim, and have become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are full age, even those who by reason of use have exercised their senses to discern both good and evil. It is important that we realize everyone is called. And every leader, you have a duty to tell people that they are called. And this course is designed to enable you that if you can receive the 9 fundamental C's, there is no doubt that you know you are called. And I won't say this, that you are called means you'll be a pastor. No. You are called means you are called to serve Elohim and called to serve his saints. And when you realize that, it doesn't mean you must be on the pulpit. In fact, as I told you several times, there seems to be a disease called microphonesis, where some people are addicted to think that it is when you handle a microphone, that's ministry. No. If you are not called to microphone, leave microphone for those who are called. There are many other things than microphone. There are many other things you can have pleasure in, joy in. There are many things you can be fulfilled in. Some are called to the marketplace. Some are called to the pulpit. Some are called to supportive ministries. Find your calling. Have joy in your calling. Fulfill your calling. You will never regret it. Number two, it is also this, that as we understand that we are created and redeemed, you know, for specific purpose on this side of eternity, that we too are called to ministry, emphasize, receive those two truths in one. That everyone has a purpose and everyone has a calling. Purpose, calling. If you can teach this to any group of saints, invest time to discover your purpose, the purpose of the Father for you, why he created you, why he redeemed you, why he called you, why he keeps you alive. And then the particular calling through which you are going to fulfill that purpose, if you can discover these two things, you will never be a babe. Number three, one of the best things to happen to us is to prayerfully discover and connect humbly with vessels Elohim ordained and equipped to nurture you or pastor you or mentor you into your assigned ministry. Everybody is not the same. Don't kid yourself that everybody is the same. No. The people you are going to meet, some of them are to be just one of the pali-pali, you know, hello, hello, hi, how are you doing? Yes. Some people have assignments in your life. If you are proud, you will see them. If you are proud, you will acknowledge them. Don't go and give yourself a pastor. Allow the Lord to plant you. And when the Lord plants you, get there. Stay there. Don't go looking for people up and down. There are people whose eyes are full of, you know, spiritually, adultery is their default setting. So they cannot sit down. And you despise that pastor the Lord gave you because his English is not so sound, because he doesn't wear those high dresses, because he doesn't have those expensive shoes. His altar is not expensively decorated, yet he's the person the Father ordained for you. You have no business despising the person. There are those the Lord has assigned to mentor you or support you into the next level. And when you begin to use your eyes to choose, the danger is that you miss that person the Lord gave to you. Amen and brethren, If you are going to walk in fullness of destiny, discover the people, connect with the people the Father has put in your life for a purpose, either to mentor you or to nurture you or to pastor you or generally to encourage you. And when you are with them, listen, be honest, serve as unto the Lord. You know what the Bible says, Luke 16:12? If you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? This is a true saying. A lot of people, you are in a ministry and every day you are making your computation, what to do. You are making your tithes, you withhold your tithes and offering. So you use it to plan to go and rent a place. No, don't do that. In the city of Port Harcourt, Nigeria, a time ago, when people in the oil industry were earning big money, instead of being faithful in their place of work, some of them would go to look for, okay, this pastor now, I need a place I can control. They go and look for the associate pastor and say, you know what, let's team up. You have the spiritual, I have the funds. Let's team up and do ministry. You run the ministry, I'm the chairman, board of trustees. I control the money. What kind of rubbish is that, men and brethren? We need to make sure that wherever the Lord plants you, give your best there. Don't be half and half. Don't be insincere. Don't withhold. It's a seed you are sowing. The seed you sow will come back to you. Men and brethren, people, at times people say, look at us, say, why is it that things, everything you lay your hands in ministry, it seems to prosper? I don't think it's necessary that we don't pay the price of prayer and diligence and all that. Yes, all those things happen. But I think there's also something to do with the way he taught us. And the three ministries we basically were connected with before the Lord separated us onto this work, all the four, the testimony you can get is that of pouring out our all to whoever was the leader. Poured out all. Affirmed them, strengthened them, pointed to them, never took their place, never. We stayed under the shadow. We are aware our time had not come. We are aware of that. And so we joyfully supported them. We joyfully invested everything. We took ministries that were not our own too. All that were given to us was piece of paper. Piece of paper, just like this, a sheet of paper folded into two with some things written here and there, and that was all. And in both cases, we had to literally, from beginning, articulate the fullness of what we're seeing in them, put it on paper, and begin to set out the manpower, the training of people, the deployment of the people, and give our lives for them. And that's why when people play funny, in all the things committed to our trust, we intercede for them. Because there's a mandate. I remember in 2006, the Lord says, son, by myself. And then in 2009, I repeated it in a major way, that whatever I've committed your trust is a done deal. And you would never lack human beings. You would never lack saints. You would never lack those who will come alongside. And if anybody doesn't come alongside, leave him alone and just focus on the ones. And I want to say to you, be faithful wherever you are planted. Don't play games. Don't play any games. Don't withhold anything because you are making your own investment for your future. Number four, although everyone is called into ministry, this does not negate the need for the authority vested in the fivefold, which is simply the headship gifts of Yeshua. I've told you before, you want to be a bishop, it's your personal desire. You ask apostles in the city and prophets, they will consecrate a bishop. But the fivefold is given by Yeshua. And the purpose is articulated in Ephesians 4, 11 and 12 and up to 16. And though everybody is called to ministry, the priesthood of the order of Melchizedek, yet the Father places the fivefold for a purpose. So if you see the fivefold and anybody in the fold, please receive them, embrace them by the grace of the Father. If their character backs up their calling, receive what the Father has from them and don't despise it. Number 5 point, realize that Elohim always processes those he calls. From the day he called you, let's say it's this, to the day he commissions you or manifests you, let's say it's there, in between both of them is what is called process, a period of process, a time when the Lord literally slow cooks you. He allows situations to come your way, circumstances that will bring out what is in you. The uncomfortableness you feel, the press you feel is part of your process. People are going to misuse you. People are going to use you despitefully. People are going to try to undermine you. These things are all part of your process. They don't destroy you. Embrace your process. Your process is bespoke. Embrace it. My process may not be your own process. That's why we tell people, we make a distinction between the truth of the word and our personal experience. So we tell you, you don't have to embrace certain things that we had to do. For instance, the Father said, lay all aside. Every money I give to you, lay it aside so that you can do this work. Now, I don't say to everybody, do that, because this is my own process. This is the process of Pastor Grace. I mean, that process may not be required of you. You may be required to work. You may be required to earn millions and use it for a kingdom expansion. You may be required to be Joseph of Arimathea, who had his business and had his stature, had access to the Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor, and he had such a stature, he could say to Pontius Pilate, can you give me the body of that Yeshua? He's my master. Let me give him a decent burial. Nobody could approach a Roman soldier, not to talk of a Roman governor. Pontius Pilate was a disciple. Nicodemus was a disciple. He was still allowed to remain a Pharisee, I mean in the Sanhedrin, so that he could exert his influence when it was much needed. Yet, Peter, James, and John, he said, leave all, leave father, leave mother, leave all and follow me, in the book of Matthew chapter 4. So please, that's why we say to leaders, your process is bespoke. Don't teach your process as the only process. People have their specific processes with their father. Realize that at the right time, the father will manifest you. He will open a door for you. Number six, as an individual, you must give yourself over to know how Elohim calls you, the various ways he speaks to you, the specific way he has been speaking to you, and how to respond promptly to his call. It is important. The way he calls A may not be the way he calls B. The way he speaks to A may not be the way he speaks to B. There are about 17 to 21 ways Elohim speaks. Out of those 17 to 21 ways, if you check very well, there may be 3, 4, 5 that are particular to you. He may speak audibly to somebody, to some other person, he speaks to the word, when the word is made alive. To another person, he may speak through providential circumstance. To another person, he may speak through burden he lays on your heart. To another person, he may speak through the revelatory gifts, prophecy, word of knowledge, word of wisdom, dreaming of dreams, interpretation of dreams. He may speak through even trances, open visions. He may speak through different things. He may speak through tongues and interpretation of tongues. He may speak in different ways to you. Get to know how he speaks to you. Get to know how he calls you. Number seven, it is your responsibility to realize and deal with constraints which may impair your ability to be all that Elohim ordained you to be. Again, this is also bespoke. The kind of mountains before you may vary from the kind of mountains before you. And by the way, among barriers that may be before you, we looked at Psalm 18 the other day when the Lord gave a word. There are people, what is always around you or in front of you are troops. And the Lord said, run through the troop, not by the side, not by the side, run through the troop. There are others, what is before them is walls. And the Father said, leap over the walls. Don't go to the right. Don't go to the left. Leap over the walls. Others is mountain that is before you. He says, speak to the mountain. Not just speak to the mountain. Give the mountain you speak to a relocation assignment. If you command the mountain to be moved, where are you sending it? If you don't send it anywhere, the mountain that you command to be moved will be lifted up and will come right back there worse than before. But you need to give the mountain a locational assignment. Is it to the Bermuda Triangle? Is it to the Arabian Desert? Is it to the Atlantic Ocean? Is it to the Sahara Desert? Give it a relocational assignment and then possess the headstone or capstone thereof and occupy that space, and there will be no possibility of the mountain returning your life. Some people's problem is that they command mountains to move, but they don't give them relocation assignments, and the mountain comes right back worse, more big, more and more strong. So learn to distinguish when is it a troop for you to run through, when it is a wall for you to leap over, when it is a mountain for you to speak and command and give a relocation assignment. Is your responsibility to understand how the Lord wants you to deal with constraints between you and what the Father has called you to be. But remember, The worst constraint you can face is inside of you. It's in your mindset. It's in your heart. It's in your attitude. If you have a worldly mindset, it's going to affect you. For all that is in the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, they are inside. If the spirit of the world is latched into you, you won't go far with Elohim. No matter how much you pray, no matter how much you try, you will put a cap over yourself. Number eight, at certain stages of your life, you need to hear from Holy Spirit concerning where to place particular saints in your sphere of influence. This is so important. Let people be. Don't try to control people's response to you. No. The Father wants us to live a certain way. Learn to be patient. The Bible says, he that believeth shall not make haste. When you are walking with people, if people prefer to walk far from you, you remember when Yeshua called Peter and said, follow me. And the Bible said that the other disciple, that is John, began to follow, and Peter turned and said, what shall this man do? Yeshua said, what does it concern you? When you are living the way the Father wants you to live, and he's giving you assignment, throw it open in the air. There are those the Father will speak to you specifically, that these ones are like John the Beloved, your innermost circle, your confidant. It may not be more than one, two, or three people who he makes your confidant. Discern them. Embrace their calling as confidants, because they will keep your confidence. The people you can sound off certain things strategic that Satan will not hear, other people will not hear to go and stop. If you locate such a person, value that relationship. Treasure it. Don't play with it. There are also people like Yeshua will do. He will call three people, Peter, James, and John. You know what? Peter, James, and John, he spent more time with them. In some critical assignments like the unveiling of his nature, the unveiling of his glorified being on the mountain of transfiguration, he took only Peter, James, John. He left others at the foot of the mountain. Not only that, when he was going to the Garden of Gethsemane to settle everything with the Father, he also left others outside the garden. He took these three inside. There are people who are the innermost circle. Again, the Father will show you. If you are open, if you are not proud, you are not considered, the Father will show you who they are. Make them there. There are people who will make your inner circle, like the 12 disciples up to Yeshua. Those he took them, invested in them, prepared them. After 3.5 years, he handed over to them. You know what? Find them. These are people who are going to be your leadership. Here in M Park, in the London Borough of Haverhill, there are people we meet with every Friday. That's the leadership. That's the leadership. Those number of people we meet with, 15, 16 people or so, those people are the leadership. Then the trustees are different. And men and brethren, then everyone who is a minister, of course, among the 70 that is sent for to go and preach. Yeshua sent 70 to go and preach, two by two. Then there was a 120 who waited till the door of Pentecost in the upper room. There was a 500 who saw him the day, and 380 out of that 500 went to preach a half gospel, as we told you the other day. And there was also the 500 who saw him that day. And there was the innumerable company of people who came to eat bread, who came to watch his miracles, who came to be healed. Men and brethren, know where to place people. Otherwise, people will destroy your ministry or destroy your life before time. So you need to discern where people are. And so when people begin to drift away from you, or begin to play hard catch up, begin to play hard to come, or they seem not to be interested, or they seem to prefer distance, don't try to pressure them. No. Leave people. Because what may be playing out is Holy Spirit doing for you what you couldn't do for yourself. Number nine, do not be like many who make a shipwreck of their faith when they do not prepare, but presumptuously plunge into ministry or function in ignorance without requisite depth of grace. There are people who don't prepare. They just plunge into ministry. Don't be like them. Say, Holy Ghost is my mentor. Holy Ghost is my teacher. You know, that's true. Holy Ghost is teacher. But Holy Ghost also has structured the church of Yeshua in such a way that everybody is supposed to be subject to the higher powers. Don't be like those who despise process, who just grab whatever you want to grab. Grab a title, print a business card, begin to call yourself names on title. If you are not able to be subject to authority, how do you want to be an authority? No, you have to be subject before you can do exercise authority. Otherwise, you might be exercising illegitimate authority. Number 10, the worst offenders are those who reject the plain teaching of the word altogether and opt for Babylonian systems which seek to gather crowds of people into buildings in order to own them and milk them for self-aggrandizement. We call this the ABC syndrome. Most Bible colleges and theological seminaries basically prepare you for ABC Christianity, where you are going to be standing before a crowd. So what matters is, how can you get them into that building? Attendance, building, is it only about that? No, it's about what they have in their pocket, cash, ABC. And so if you go to learn ABC from that preacher, that popular preacher, and people are bringing money and money is flowing in and they are building bigger campuses and they have crowd around them, you're on the wrong paradigm. Men and brethren, that paradigm will never help you. 11, as an individual, it is your responsibility to submit to a process of training and equipping in order to fully understand and do enduring ministry built on the solid ground of character. And you have no one to blame but yourself if you just grab anything you see. You don't care about their theological basis. And you see some people inside their articles of faith are things that negate the high priestly role of Yeshua, that negate, you know, the priesthood of all believers. And you just go and grab that. How can you train in a place that tells you that women cannot be ministers? How can you take training in such a place? Don't go and pollute yourself. And that's one of the reasons the Father raised Global School of Ministry and a master class, that through the Global School of Ministry, the body of knowledge, any saint can truly take in and imbibe and use it to be all the Father ordained them to be in terms of ministry. Is now available free of charge. If you go to kingdombooksclub.com, you see the curriculum, and you can take the curriculum of Global School of Ministry. The master class is available, where Pastor Grace and I teach. And then there are mentors across the world who are available to help you to press in. You also can see www.globalschoolofministry.info. And we say to you, these materials are now in ebook form for you. Each book is a course, by the way. Volume 1 of the book, Holy Spirit, Who Is and What It Does, Apostle Dr. Catherine Jones, the managing editor, has just released it a few days ago. It's now available for your download on the website. And there's also YouTube videos for you to equip yourself. You can actually train with a number of people gathering together. And one of you who has a teaching grace can help you through, and you can receive the teaching directly. And of course, there are many ministries that I've taken on. And then number 12, we need to determine, therefore, that no one will take an appointed place in the kingdom. In it was said of Judas Iscariot, his bishopric, let another take. May you never come to the place that what the Father ordained for you, because of your inability to see it, to get it, to walk in it, the Father say, okay, fine, go ahead, be distracted. And he raises somebody else who was not in the frame, in the eyes of human beings, to take your place. And so the grand key, men and brethren, recognize the grace of Elohim in your life and give it space to grow. And you know what? The Father loves you and He'll bless you. This course is ordained to unleash something in you. So the assignment for today is this. Which of these 12 imperatives speak to your current situation in life? Which of them do you need to take on board? Which of these 12, imperatives? Then let's go on to the last epilogue and we close out this course today. Tomorrow, we'll speak from the heart. If there's time, Pastor Grace and I will do that together. Otherwise, I'll do that. Depending on if she's available for that tomorrow, we'll just take a little short exhortation to everyone. Listen to this. By the grace of the Father, on Thursday, you do the course, you do both the panel discussion and the course impact assessment will be released Thursday or Friday. And on Friday, some of the mentors would, along with the director of studies, speak to you, those who are in the class. And we will share with you on Facebook Live on that Friday, okay? But please listen to this. There is the last part of the epilogue, and it deals with six divine tools for perfection and empowerment that the Lord has ordained for you to go with on earth. The six of them, listen. Number one, the word of Elohim. The word of Elohim has been abused by people when it's convenient for them. Exalted when it's convenient, they exalt it. When it's not convenient, they abuse it. But listen, Psalm 138 verse 2, we are told, I worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above thy entire name. The Lord has magnified his word above his name. The word is supposed to be the basis of every transaction. And Satan knows that, and he's making people to despise the word. And people are now talking from their mind or from their emotion, from their feeling. They are talking. Some people can go to the pulpit to preach, and what they preach is their feeling or their subjective, what they think, what they see. Men and brethren, this is terrible. Brethren, the word is still the basis of life, because the Bible tells us very clearly that, listen, in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the word of Elohim, which liveth and abideth forever. Yeshua is the living word, and his word must be taken seriously. There's a word for everything. The Lord expects us, according to Joshua 1:8 and Psalm 1:1-3, we need to dwell in the word, meditate in the word, let the word marinate inside of us, and let's study to show ourselves as proved unto Elohim as workmen that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. When the word begins to power everything we think, say, and do, begin to power our attitude. Somebody can offend you. In that moment, offense wants to come, the word reveals to you, is not necessary. You can shut it down. Was it not David who spoke to his own soul? He said, oh, my soul, be quiet within me. David shut down the motion of his flesh. Why was it so? Because the word he hid in his heart, that he would not sin against Elohim. Learn to embrace the word. Give the word right of way to do what he ought to do in your life. Number two is the name of Yeshua. The name of Yeshua. The name is still a strong tower. The righteous run to it and is safe. And the Lord wants us to know that everything we can ever receive from heaven, the name of Yeshua will procure them. The name is powerful. The name is magnetic. The name is able to open every door. He said, whatever you ask in his name, he will give you. In Mark 16, 17, and these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. John 14, 13 to 14. Whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. John 14, 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things, bring all things to your remembrance, whatever I said unto you. John 15, 16, you have not chosen you, but I have chosen you, ordained you, that you go forth and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, he'll give it to you. Men and brethren, John 16, 23, 24, in that day you shall ask me nothing. Very, very, I say unto you, whatsoever I shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask and receive, that your joy may be full. I want to ask you, what have you asked in his name? If you don't ask in his name, you are asking your own name, and your name cannot open any door. The key to heaven is his name. His name is so powerful that when they were persecuting the early church, you know what they told them? Did we not tell you not to preach in that name? And Peter told them, there's no salvation in any other than that name. Men and brethren, his name is himself. His name is identity. When you call his name, you know. I told you the other time when I preached, I was teaching here, that if somebody in a crowd, you know, maybe 10,000 people, 5,000, 3,000 in an airport or football field, just said, Apostle, There may be 25, 30, 40 people if the apostles may just turn to look. But if somebody says, Apostle George, maybe only those called George who are apostles, maybe there may be three of them may look. But if somebody says, Apostle George Akalonu, there's only one person that will turn. This brother here. The name is you. His name is him. Let's learn the power of his name. That whatever we want to approach heaven, we approach heaven because he has borne the flesh and blood. And he has gone to the cross and is our high priest and is there waiting to support us. The third thing that we need for transition, for transformation, to access the mysteries of heaven is the blood of Yeshua. The blood of Yeshua is the blood of the new covenant. It's the blood of the eternal covenant. By that blood, we can receive purging, sanctification, purification. Any thought that crosses your mind that is impure, that is not holy, that is not of the Father, you can deal with it not only by pulling it down and casting it out, you can also deal with it effectually by applying the blood to your mind and to your tongue and to your attitude and to anything, because the blood purges, the blood sanctifies. Let's learn to take a deep dive into the pool of the blood anytime and every time. Any little infraction, don't say it doesn't matter. Men and brethren, the blood is also the instrument of defeating Satan ultimately. We are told in Revelation chapter 12, verse 11, and they, that's the saints, the remnant, overcame him, Satan, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They loved not their lives even unto death. Learn to deal with Satan with the blood of the Lamb. The blood is a settled victor anytime. In any realm, in the heavenlies, on earth, underneath the earth, anywhere the blood is declared and proclaimed, there will be sanitization, there will be sanctification, there will be expulsion of satanic activity. The fourth instrument of victory is the presence and power of Holy Spirit. Men and brethren, right from the first day of creation, we are told, in the beginning Elohim created the heaven and the earth. How did he create it? The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters. Creation came about because he moved upon the face of the waters. Men and brethren, when it was time for the new covenant, how did it happen? The same way, in Luke 1:35, the angel Gabriel told Mary, Holy Ghost will come upon you, and he will plant the body that will become Yeshua. So the incarnation took place by instrument of Holy Spirit. And after 30 years, when Yeshua was mature to go forth, how did he go forth? At the baptism of John, Holy Spirit came upon him without measure. John 1:31-32. And John 3:34. And when Yeshua was now going into ministry, all the 3.5 years, after preparing in obscurity for 30 years, the 3.5 years of ministry, we're told in Acts 10:38, everything he did, going about doing good, it was because of Holy Spirit that was upon him. And that's why he prayed for us, his disciples and us. In John chapter 14, he told us that, when the Comforter, Holy Ghost, shall come, whom the Father will send in his name, he shall teach us all things. So Holy Spirit is available to teach us all things. He's available to empower us. And so in the Alpha Church, he sealed them into Yeshua. Right now, he wants to seal everyone at the point of being a believer into Yeshua. Number two, he transforms our lives from inside out. That's why we're able to grow from glory to glory. That people see us today, who saw us last 10 years ago, 5 years ago, 1 year ago, they can testify about the intimacy with the Lord, the attitude, the mindset, the worldview. There's a change. Why? Because Holy Spirit was at work with the word, with the blood. He also, teaches us all things. He teaches us the deep mysteries of the word, And he doesn't stop. As he's put me in the book of Revelation, the Father, I was before him today and I said, Father, yes, what are you saying? He said, yes, I want my people to know that from Genesis to Malachi, shares about the creation and all the past. Kingdom given in Genesis 1, kingdom lost in Genesis 3, and all the Old Testament approach to restore the kingdom, but because their hearts were not ready, then the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That's why you need to study the Digging Deep series. You need to diligently, please, Saturday, Sunday, if you're in a master class, don't take it lightly. Because as Pastor Grace is breaking down all that Yeshua began to do and say, and the doctrines of the word of Elohim, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John tells us about the biography of Yeshua, his life, his times, his teachings, his instruction. These are ordinances of the kingdom. If you don't understand Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you may not have confidence in him. You may not understand him as a Messiah. So that's why it is there. And then the Pauline epistles are given to reveal to us our identity in Yeshua. And then, listen to this. The book of Revelation now tells us what is about to come. What is happening now? What happened in the past? What is happening now? And what is about to come? I say, it is not by accident that the church world has been deceived by Satan. They don't touch the book of Revelation. They don't touch it. Yet these things will happen. Yet there are people who, if they know what is in the book of Revelation, it will enable them to prepare and make adjustments today. There'll be no presumptuousness, because we also have confidence to know that as Satan was a created being, he has an end in the lake of fire and brimstone, and nobody wants to be part of it, because that place was not meant for you and I. It was not meant for anyone born again. It was meant for him and the demons who followed him in his rebellion. And so the Father was showing me why he wanted me to get back into the book of Revelation again and dwell in it line by line, waiting on him every morning. Men and brethren, listen to this. It now shows clearly that why would Satan keep believers blinded to what is about to happen? In fact, some of them are already unfolding. The day Revelation 13 will be fulfilled, there will be no announcement. It will be swift, it will be sudden. And before you know it, the beasts and the false prophets are in power. Brothers and sisters, as an individual, I tell you, I believe the days are nearer than when we ever knew, ever. In all history, there's been never a time where these things have seemed to be so together. The system is in place. All it needs is two people fully manifesting the fullness of their identity. And they are not demons. They are human beings who Satan will give his power, who will operate in the nature of Satan and in the power of Satan. And you better get ready, brethren, because what is about to come upon the earth, if you see what is in Revelation chapter 6 and 7, if your eyes are open to them, you know why nobody should take chances. Why would you take chances with lying? Why would you take chances with, you know, all kinds of funny things, all kinds of things, as if Elohim is not omniscient, omnipresent, as if he's no longer omnipotent? Is it because sentence against an evil work is not judged swiftly that people are doing all kinds of stuff? Holy Spirit gives us sufficient power to represent the Father in our assignment. And then, men and bread number 5, we also learn what we need is the sufficiency of the grace of Elohim. His grace, which we are told in 2 Peter 3:18, may grow in grace and in knowledge of our Lord and Savior Yeshua. To him be glory, both now and forever. Amen. Grace will enable us to overcome. Grace will enable us to run this race to the end. Grace is his power. His power working through us, not our power. His strength working through us. Grace is what he gives to us freely. It's not by our strength. It's not by our power. And the Father says, embrace my grace. Allow my grace to run through you. Allow my grace to carry you on. The glorious truths, 16 of them, and the fundamental seeds, 9 of them, if you allow the Lord to teach you the revelation of truth in them and take through all the scriptural references without rushing, if you take 1 month or 2 to study these 2 courses until they are made flesh in you, the revelation thereof, You'll never fail. Why? Grace will be released in you. Grace is his power. Grace is his strength. Grace is his ability. And the Father says, stop running on your own strength. That's why you are fainting. That's why you are tired. That's why you are tired of the word. That's why you cannot enjoy the word. It's because you are not taking it by grace. You are looking at it as a mountain. It's not a mountain. The word being given to you is not given as a mountain. It's not given to make you faint. If you can receive a measure of truth every day, I'm talking about truth that leads you into authentic kingdom culture, where your whole life, your whole outlook, your whole worldview, your whole mind is kingdom. Do you know what? The Lord was sharing me the other day. The average believer spends 8 to 10 hours fostering the world system, strengthening it, empowering the world system. There's nothing wrong with that. Doing your job, it's okay. But if your whole strength goes to foster the world system, then something is wrong. Your values are jaded. They are not in proper alignment. How many people will say, Lord, forbid that I will foster the world system and it will dominate my consciousness? The sixth thing you need is faith, raw faith, overcoming faith. Romans 1:17, for therein is the righteousness of Elohim revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. The just, the righteousness you receive in Yeshua, it came by faith. You are saved by grace through faith. It's a gift from the Father, but you need to appropriate it in laying hold of it and walking with it. Faith is a shield. The shield of faith. Faith is also the instrument of moving mountains. Faith is everything. The Bible says we should hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. In Hebrews 10:23, because Elohim is faithful. What has he spoken to you? Hold on to it. Believe it in your heart. Confess it with your tongue and walk in faith. The Bible says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Men and brethren, come to the place where you receive it, that without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he ever comes to Elohim must believe that he is, and is the rewarder of them that diligently seeks him. And Elohim wants us to come to that place where these six things work together for our empowerment, for us to be who the Father has called us to be. Men and brethren, listen to this. You need to come to the place where you say to yourself, if not now, when shall we ensure that the 9 fundamental seeds are part of our experiential reality? Not just head knowledge. Experiential reality. You walk in them. If not you, who shall receive his full salvation package and respond to it in this way? The assignment for today. Number one, please summarize the power of the word, the name of Yeshua, the blood of Yeshua, the power of Holy Spirit, any 4 of them, anyway, any 4 of these 6 that appeal to you, summarize that you need. Summarize what the word says here. Cite at least 1 scripture. And number 2, what lessons are you taking away from this? What is the message you're taking away from this lesson? Brothers and sisters, the glorious truths have been taught in 10 video lessons, 20 written lessons. And you know what? It's short, but I believe it's powerful. This course affected me deeply. This course. If you allow the truth to get into you, you never remain the same. You'll walk in a different format. And I encourage every one of you to receive it. Now, I'm going to make a birthday announcement, but before then, let me pray with you and then we'll make the birthday announcement on camera. Father, I pray for your saints across the world who have listened to this live and those who will be watching on television, watching on YouTube, and watching on Facebook live stream when they're able to access it again. Lord, I pray that the truth in your word will not fall on the ground, but rather it will pierce through every heart and mind. It will deposit something in your people. Virtue will bring about transformation from the inside of it, that your people become all you ordained them to be. Father, I pray that the saints across the world will walk in the experiential reality of the fundamental seeds, and your name shall be glorified. Thank you, Father, for we know you have answered in Yeshua's name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we want to also celebrate the birthday of Pastor Charles Story. Pastor Charles Story and his wife, Pastor Tony, they are members of the National Advisory Council of IMF USA, and they now live in Texas. We bless you, Pastor Charles, and pray for everyone who is in the USA. And if you have interest in the USA, the National Conference is 19th to 21 July. 19th to 21 July in Meriden, Connecticut. There's a poster on my page, or you can contact the people listed there. You know, please, you can contact them and book your space. It's been made easy. There are rooms for one, rooms for two to share, rooms for three to share, and rooms for four to share, depending on your budget. And you all can plan it. And the fees listed, they are for both accommodation and feeding. We welcome you to come. Pastor Grace and I will be right there to encourage the brethren and to also help to explain the vision in detail. You know, on the Saturday, we'll also explain the vision in detail and some of the things the Father wants to see in place that will make us to all get to the next level. Young people, there's a summit on 18th evening, Thursday, 18th July, and Friday morning, a youth summit. You can't miss it. You can also make your place, even if you're after outside the country, they send you a letter of invitation before it's too late, and you can apply for visa. The US, UK, United Kingdom, the conference is on 12th and 13th, exactly 1 weekend before then, at 821 Old Kent Road. And you know what? You're invited. Pastor Grace and I will be there to be with you, and we say to you, come at the Redeemed Assembly Trust, and we all will have fellowship together. I want to bless the Father for every one of you who has been part of this course and the glorious truth. And very soon, the way Apostle Catherine is walking, before the month is over, she may get it out as ebook, second edition, both this and the fundamental seeds and the glorious truth. Have a blessed day. I thank Pastor Grace and Elect for being on the camera today. May the Father bless them. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen. And amen.